UCC, UCC, the forest to your God. UCC, UCC, to the call, let us rise to our call. Let us rise where it has no peace.
Thank you. Kindly take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the singular honor of introducing our chairperson for this afternoon's inaugural lecture. Our chair is a pharmacist and a biomedical scientist, a Ghana College of Pharmacists fellow, a Japan International Cooperation Agency JICA scholar, and a postgraduate Institute of Medical Education and Research C.V. Raman scholar. He is a member of the Association of African Universities and has consulted worldwide on community pharmacy practice. He is also a member of numerous international and local professional bodies. Our chairman has taught at various levels and supervised a number of MPhil and PhD students from different backgrounds. He has climbed through the ranks of this university and has been at the forefront of academic leadership in key areas. Presently, he is the Vice Chancellor of University of Cape Coast. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome our chairman, Professor Johnson Nyakon Buampong.
Thank you, MC. Professor Mrs. Rosemond Bohin, Pro Vice Chancellor, UCC. Mr. Jephthah Emmanuel Unyame, Registrar. Nananom. Professor Kweku Educhum Eyimboache, Vice Chancellor, Cape Coast Technical University, Cape Coast. Pro Vice Chancellors of sister universities present. Registrars of sister universities. Reverend Professor Emmanuel Adorbin, former Vice Chancellor, UCC. Professor D.D. Kupori, former Vice Chancellor, UCC. Professor Joseph Gatte Ampere, former Vice Chancellor, UCC. Professor Victor Patrick Yagajipo, former President, Central University. Professor Joshua Usu-Seche, former Vice Chancellor, Cape Coast Technical University. Professor John Nesimboa, former Pro Vice Chancellor, UCC. Professor George K.T. Odro, former Pro Vice Chancellor, UCC. Professor Dora Francisca Edubuando, former Pro Vice Chancellor, UCC. Provost, Deans, Directors of Academic and Administrative Units, Heads of Departments, and Heads of Hall, Members of Convocation, Staff and Students, Distinguished invited guests, friends in the media, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. On behalf of the Governing Council, management, staff, and students of the University of Cape Coast, I welcome you to today's professorial inaugural lecture to be delivered by Professor Ishmael Mensah. We say accra, we appreciate your presence and support. Distinguished invited guests, within the academy, inaugural lectures provide the occasion for universities to acknowledge the appointment or promotion of academics to the rank of professor, introduce them, and provide them with the opportunity to engage with the university community. An inaugural lecture is therefore is significant milestones in academic career, recognizing their promotion to professor. Ladies and gentlemen, these lectures form key part of the traditions of the University of Cape Coast, where we create the platform to enable our astute professors to showcase to the university-wide audience their research or their perspectives on issues of interest to them. Each lecture provides an opportunity for academics to share, among others, the achievements in research, innovation, engagement, and teaching activities before an audience of members of the university community and the general public. As you already know, it is the only time an academic gets to profess what he knows or thinks without being questioned. Though Professor Ishmael Mensah was promoted to the professorial rank in 2020, it is today that he will celebrate this important personal milestone with a broad audience, including members of the public, family, friends, and colleagues, both old and new. Professor Ishmael Mensah will synthesize his scholarship and contribution to knowledge in his field of specialization, which is tourism and hospitality management, in the inaugural lecture captioned "Evolution of Coastal Tourism in Ghana, Paradise Found, Paradise Lost, or Paradise Regained." Professor Mensah will deliver the lecture in a simplified manner so that individuals who do not belong to the same field with him would understand what he has come to see. Ladies and gentlemen, before Professor Ishmael Mensah steps forward to deliver his inaugural lecture, permit me to read his profile. Professor Ishmael Mensah is a professor of tourism and hospitality management and the immediate past Ghana director of the Confucius Institute at the University of Cape Coast. He has also served as an external expert at Hunan City University in China. His education. Professor Ishmael Mensah holds a BSc in tourism, MPhil in tourism, and PhD in tourism degrees from the University of Cape Coast. He also received postgraduate certificates in hospitality administration as well as event planning and trade show management from Georgia State University. His other qualifications include a certificate in the supervision of doctoral candidates at African universities from the University of Stellenbosch and a certificate in leading for equity, diversity, and inclusion in higher education from the University of Michigan. Academic and professional career. His academic career began August 2004 when he was appointed as a senior research assistant at the SWA Department of Geography and Tourism, University of Cape Coast. He rose through the ranks, becoming a lecturer in 2006, a senior lecturer in 2010, an associate professor in 2015, and finally, a professor in 2020. He's done well. Becoming a professor in UCC is not an easy task. Apart from teaching a number of courses within and outside the University of Cape Coast, He has supervised about 10 PhDs and 15 MPhils. He has also mentored several younger professionals and facilitated several training programs. Professor Mensah is a member of some professional associations, including the Institute of Hospitality and International Council on Hotel, Restaurant, and Institutional Education, SCAR International, and the International Society for Development and Sustainability. Leadership. Professor Mensah has served in various capacities in this university, and this includes academic advisor, registration officer, examination officer, and industrial attachment coordinator of the Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management. He was also a hall tutor for the Kelsey Hayford Hall and Ghana Director of the Confucius Institute at the University of Cape Coast. He has also chaired and served on several boards and committees, both within and outside the University of Cape Coast. And this includes United Nations Group of Experts of the Regular Process for Global Reporting and Assessment of the State of the Marine Environment, including socio-economic aspects, and the Ghana Tertiary Education Council, JTEC, Accreditation Panel for Tourism and Hospitality Programs. Publication and editorial roles. Professor Ishmael Mensah has published widely in high-ranking academic journals in areas of destination marketing, service quality, environmental management in hotels, special event management, and community-based tourism development. He has over 50 publications, including 8 books, 15 book chapters, and 33 peer-reviewed articles. His editorial experience includes serving on the editorial board of the Ogwa Journal of Social Sciences and Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Education, as well as serving as an associate editor of the Frontiers of Psychology. He also co-edits the Proceedings of the China-Africa Urban Development Forum. He is the founding editor-in-chief of the African Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Management. He's been ranked among the top 10 scientists in the field of tourism and hospitality in Africa by the AD Scientific Index 2023. Professor Mensah has made a significant contribution to knowledge in the field of environmental management in the tourism and hospitality industry. His article entitled Environmental Management Practices Among Hotels in the Greater Accra Region, which was published in the International Journal of Hospitality Management, is one of the most influential works in the field. In addition, his co-authored book, Marketing Tourist Destinations in Emerging Economies, Towards Creating Competitive and Sustainable Emerging Tourist Destinations, has been listed among the 8 best new tourism books to read in 2023 by Book Authority. He's done well. Community and Extension Services. Professor Mensah is very passionate about delivery of quality service and has sought out for a number of public and private organizations, including Ghana Dock Labor Company Limited, Electricity Company of Ghana, Ghana Tourism Authority, Center for National Culture, and Ghana Museums and Monuments Board on Tourism. He also serves as a standard examiner for a number of universities, including Koforidua Technical University, Ho Technical University, University of Energy and Natural Resources, University of KwaZulu-Natal, Durban University of Technology, University Technology, Mara, and Honan City University. He was also a visiting lecturer in the University of Girona. Professor Ishmael Mensah has delivered keynote presentations, speeches, seminars, webinars, and workshops at both academic and professional conferences in a number of institutions, including University of Papua New Guinea, MIT University, Kolkata University Technology, Mara, and University of Santo Tomas in Legazpi. About his personal life, Professor Mensah is a Christian who fellowships with the Pentecost International Worship Center in Cape Coast. She is married to Professor Mrs. Rebecca D. Mensah. Is she here? Let's see you. Thank you. And the couple have been blessed with three lovely children, Nana, Araba, and Arabna. Thank you for your attention. Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Che. Can we do it for him whilst he takes his seat? Ahead of the presentation by Professor Mensah this afternoon, I would like to call on Gideon Afezi with Gilbert Kumasin Bands of the Department of Music to give us an interlude. Let's welcome him.
Faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. So we say, great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, Your mercy I see. All I have needed, Thy hand has provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness. Your mercy and love. So great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gideon Afasi. It's time to listen to the lecture. This afternoon, the presentation is on the topic, Evolution of Coastal Tourism in Ghana, Paradise Found, Paradise Lost, or Paradise Regained. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome our speaker, Professor Ishmael Mensah.
Mr. Chairman and Vice Chancellor of this great university, distinguished invited guests, friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, let me take this opportunity to welcome you all to this august gathering. Mr. Chairman, first of all, let me thank you and indeed management of the university for this opportunity. It is indeed a privilege to stand on this pulpit. I'm so grateful. Mr. Chairman, I was born in Takwa, but by some twist of fate, I was taken to the village at Krado. And this morning, I'm happy to say the chief of my village is here. Nana Opoku Esel. My time in Krado was really enjoyable. My grandmother, my aunties, they took care of me. At a point, my mother came for me and my sister, and she took us to Accra to begin a new journey. I believe my life took a different turn in Accra. We were enrolled in one of the best schools at the time, Datus Complex Schools. As children, we used to enjoy the beach. I think many of you remember the popular Meet Me There, Dansoman Beach. We lived in Shiabu. And Shiabu, where we lived, was just about 400 meters to the beach. And so as children, we used to go and play at the beach. Now, fast forward to 2021. In December, when the ban on social gathering was lifted, I decided to visit some family members and friends in the Dansoman area. I drove through Glefe towards, those of you who know the geography of the area, I drove through Glefe. I realized that the roads were now tarred. But I also realized to my dismay that a lot of buildings had sprung up on both sides of the beach. I got lost, so I was compelled to use my Google Map. I drove for some time, and Google Map told me that you have reached your destination. Your destination is on the right. I turned right, and I only saw buildings. I was amazed. Where is Dansoman Beach? I got down, parked my car, asked for directions. A woman pointed to another direction. I went there, and it was left with just a narrow strip of the beach. Dansoman Beach was gone. So when the time came for me to present my inaugural lecture, I decided to dwell on this important topic: evolution of coastal tourism in Ghana, paradise found, paradise lost, or paradise regained. Because tourism is one of our highest earning export commodities. In fact, tourism is an invisible export. We don't bag it and then export it. People rather come here and spend their money. And beaches are important tourism resources. And so the desecration of our beaches, to me, is an issue that we have to address. And so this topic, I'm going to dwell on that. First, I'll begin with an introduction, and then I'll look at some concepts and theories. Then I'll dwell on paradise found, paradise lost, paradise regained. I'll conclude, offer some recommendations, and also highlight my contributions to knowledge. Mr. Chairman, permit me to begin with a quote by Iya, 2000, who was commenting on Bali. Bali is in Indonesia, very popular beach, which lost its appeal. According to Iya, hardly has a lost paradise been discovered than everyone converges on it so fast that it becomes a paradise lost, unquote. Mr. Chairman, this to me is reflective of certain portions of our beaches. The beach not far from where we are this afternoon. Not long ago, somebody established, I don't know whether it's a spot, a drinking spot, or a restaurant. Over time, a lot of people charged on that beachfront, started putting up all kinds of structures. I know CCMA tried to intervene, but at a point, they had to let down their guard. Now I see they have posted some notices there to deter people from further developing that beach stretch. Beaches are the main focus of the global tourism industry. Indeed, it was beaches that gave birth to modern mass tourism. For many people, the dream of a vacation is, you know, lying at the beach, in a sun-drenched, you know, beach. One of the fastest growing segments of the tourism industry is coastal tourism. And traditionally, coastal tourism has been referred to as the 4S: sun, sex, sea, and sand. Because the beaches offer avenues for leisure, recreation, and romanticism. Tourism in Ghana started along the coasts. Indeed, our colonial masters developed lodges and forts and castles along the beach, also to fulfill their own personal recreational needs. Ghana's 560-kilometer stretch of coastline is dotted with beaches, forts, castles, hotels, resorts, including even educational institutions. And I believe UCC prides itself as a rare beachfront university. However, a greater part of the beaches in Ghana appear polluted and degraded, which is a pale shadow of its former glory. Admittedly, beaches also serve other non-tourism purposes. Our fishermen, our farmers. The beaches are also used for housing purposes, for shipping, and so on and so forth. And this raises the issue of contested uses, which further aggravates the condition of our beaches. The attractiveness of a beach for tourism purposes depends on certain factors, such as the quality of the water, the sanitation situation, scenic beauty, the landscape, amenities, and facilities. And therefore, the degree of sand mining, encroachment, open defecation, pollution, and shoreline erosion of our beaches is a cause for serious concern. Some prime beaches in Dansoman and Keta have been lost, representing a paradise lost. But could beach nourishment programs, including the construction of seawalls and beach upgrading programs like the new resorts that are springing up, government is embarking on a very aggressive marine drive project. Could this be considered as paradise regained? Based on John Mitchell's epic poem, Paradise Lost and Paradise Regained, I ask these begging questions about coastal tourism in Ghana. I will seek to assess the state of coastal tourism development in Ghana. And I ask whether the current state of our beaches represents a natural evolution based on Butler's tourist area life cycle, or it is just a devolution. Now, I will dwell on certain key concepts that will enhance our understanding of my lecture. And the first concept is coastal tourism. In fact, coastal tourism has been used as a generic term to refer to travel, leisure, recreational-oriented activities which take place along the coast. And therefore, coastal tourism takes place at coastal tourism destinations. A coastal tourism destination is an area which attracts tourists who come to enjoy the seaside and sea-related activities as a primary motivation. And so we are saying that most of the coastal tourism takes place along the beach, the shore, and then the water immediately adjacent to the shoreline. It is an undeniable fact that coastal tourism thrives on attractive beaches, an entire coastline of an area. And so the quintessential coastal tourism destination will usually have coconut-fringed, wide, flat, and white, sandy, and sunny, clean beach. Also, such beaches tend to have clean, clear waters and gentle waves and currents. The other concept is paradise. And Mr. Chairman, I must emphasize that I am using paradise metaphorically. Paradise is a place or condition of great happiness where everything is perfect, is exactly as one would like it. And we can talk about the Garden of Eden. Everything was in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve were instructed not to eat only one thing, and they disobeyed. So when we talk about paradise, we are talking about scenic beauty. We are talking about tranquility, peace, a sense of awe. And therefore, if you look at the marketing brochure, you realize that most islands have been marketed as paradise. They have used this as a major marketing ploy. The other concepts are paradise found, paradise lost, paradise regained. Paradise found, obviously, when Adam and Eve were sent to the Garden of Eden, they found their paradise. So that was paradise found. In paradise lost, there was the fall of man, the temptation of Adam and Eve by the fallen angel, Satan, and their subsequent expulsion from the Garden of Eden. In paradise regained, John Milton tried to reverse the fall. And here he talked about Jesus' salvation. Christ's victory over sin and Satan as a restorative salvation opportunity for mankind to once again be in relationship with God. And so in paradise regained, Jesus came to save us from our sins. So the destruction of our beaches through sand mining and other activities represents paradise lost. The opportunity to salvage the remaining vestiges and reclaim our beaches represents paradise regained. But to regain paradise, we have to repent. The Bible says, without repentance, there is no remission of sin. And so we need attitudinal change in order to regain our paradise. Mr. Chairman, the other theory that I would highlight is self-destruct theory. In our local parlance, we will say, and you will be no commentary. Continue. The destruction of our beaches is self-inflicted. Now, based on the self-destruct theory of tourism, usually at the first phase, an attractive natural place is discovered. Then, just as the quote by Iya, once the place is discovered, people will now charge on it. So there's tourism development, massive construction of beaches, resorts, and other facilities. This will then attract more people to the destination. It opens up the destination. And that will lead to mass tourism. So you have so many people visiting the beach at a particular point in time. And that will result in phase four, where there will be decline and degradation. So you realize that this is self-destruction. The other theory is Butler's tourist area life cycle. Now, according to Butler, destinations go through a cycle of evolution. Just like human beings, we are born, we grow, we get old, we reach empty nest, we retire, we die. Destinations are also like organisms. They go through certain stages. So according to Butler, destinations go through the stages of exploration. So the first stage is exploration. The place has just been discovered. A nice beach somewhere has been discovered. So at that point in time, it's only some few adventurous tourists who visit that destination. Now, once the local people realize that the tourists are coming, they will get involved. So we reach the involvement stage, where the number of tourists increased and facilities, the local people then provide facilities to cater for those tourists. This would then usher the destination into a period of development, where the number of tourists increases rapidly and there is a noticeable, you know, change in the destination in terms of facilities. More facilities are put up. And at this stage, foreigners will get on board. The multinationals, they will come and put up, you know, plush hotels and other facilities. At the consolidation stage, which is the next phase, the growth rate of visitors, even though it will be increasing at a reducing rate. That will lead to stagnation. At stagnation, peak tourist numbers would have been achieved. The destination would have matured. And therefore, the number of tourists will start declining, and that will lead us to the decline phase, where the destination loses its appeal, and people are no longer interested in visiting the destination. Unless the destination authorities decide to put in measures to redeem the paradise by repairing and repositioning the destination. So sometimes Destinations will not necessarily go through all these stages. So, not all destinations go through the natural cycle of evolution. I mean, it's just like human beings. Sometimes, some children die out of childhood, you know, killer diseases. They don't grow. So, it's the same with the destination. Not all destinations will go through this cycle. So, Prof. Chair, that will lead us to Paradise Found. And my frame of reference will be in the 1970s. Why? Because I was born in the 1970s. Secondly, because as a country, we only became serious about tourism development in the 1970s. A number of committees were set up, like the Obuam Committee to develop a tourism development plan. And then we have Hof and Overgaard planning consultants also developing a plan, a master plan for tourism development during that period. And in the same 1970, the Ghana Tourist Control Board, which is now the Ghana Tourism Authority, was also established. So I'll make reference to that period. Personally, it was in the 1980s that I found my paradise, specifically in Shiabu. I have already told you that I grew up in Shiabu in Accra. Growing up in Shiabu was fun. We lived close to the beach, about 400 meters. There were no restraining walls. We lived in a compound house with some other, you know, families. And as children, we had the latitude, you know, to go wherever we wanted to, especially when our parents were not around. It's not like today that children are locked up in fenced, you know, houses. So we will go to the beach, we'll go and bath, we'll go and chase crabs. The 1980s were very difficult times in Ghana, politically, economically. I mean, the overthrow of Lehman, the exodus of Ghanaians from Nigeria, Ghana must go. The famine or the hunger, food shortages during that period. I remember 83, I was a child. We went through hell. So during all these difficulties, the beaches, the serenity of the beaches offered some kind of solace and a breakaway from the political and economic difficulties of the time. I remember the popular Meet Me There. As children, we would go to the beach on Easter Mondays and other holidays, you know, to look at what was happening, look at fancy cars, fashion, what have you. I mean, those were the days of Michael Jackson, you know, Michael Jackson, Madonna, and so on and so forth. We'll go and dance, listen to good music. That was our paradise. The beaches were serene, the coconut trees were there. Other plants along the beach were also in place. Ghana has a coastline of about 560 kilometers. And this is endowed with a number of marine and other resources. Generally, the Ghana coast comprises of rocky beaches, usually found in the central coast, where we are. And then a shore or a sandy shoreline on the west, on the eastern coast, and then a sandy bay on the west coast. 280 kilometers, according to my former supervisor, Professor Dare, who could not be here today. As far back as 1972, he was writing on our coastline. He was publishing on our coastline. According to him, about 280 kilometers comprised of sandy beaches. I believe today it has reduced. Also, what makes our beaches particularly ideal for tourism was the number of heritage attractions, the historical monuments, the forts and castles. Out of about 43 forts and castles connected with the transatlantic slave trade in West Africa, 33 were in Ghana alone, out of which 25 are in good shape. And so our beaches offered the right resources, the right attractions for tourism at the time. And it was no wonder that we found our paradise. Bainé, who was writing on our coastline, said that most of the coastline is fringed with coconut trees, interspersed by lagoons and river estuaries. This makes them particularly ideal for tourism. Now, if you go back to Butler's tourist area life cycle, we can equate this period to the exploration and involvement stages of the model and phases one and two of the self-destruct theory. The 1970s and 1980s, there were very few hotels, although there were some beaches, you know, which were not as popular as they are today. In 1975, the government commissioned Swedish planning consultant Hof and Overgaard to develop a tourism master plan for the country. They visited a number of attractions, and they identified a lack of quality seaside resorts in Ghana. They therefore proposed a plan for some seaside resorts to be developed. Ladies and gentlemen, it was never implemented. The reasons are not far-fetched. The political instability at the time. The Daily Graphic of Tuesday, August 8, 1977, had a screaming headline. Work to begin on 10.9 million Labadi tourist complex. Mr. Chairman, I'll beg to ask, now, Labadi tourist complex, now, or is it Medofwa Adame? It was never implemented. Because of this, the natural evolution of our beaches into the next phase, which was development phase, was disrupted. It was a missed opportunity. Mr. Chairman, that takes me to Paradise Lost. In the early 2000s, there was evidence that we were losing some of our paradise. I remember I was a student here in the late 90s. A friend that I met in Accra, you know, I knew him from Shiabu in those days. He asked me, "Ish, are you not going to buy some of the land?" I said, "Which land?" He said, "The land at Glefe." And to put it in his own words, the land that is being sold is as cheap as Kenke. Tomo, call me. You know. So I would quote Karen Kane, who is a friend that I follow on Facebook. She wrote something, and I think I identify myself with that. She said, "Let me tell you a true story. I was born and raised in Dansoman. Our family home is still in Dansoman last stop, and it's still home to my parents. When we were children, we used to walk from where our home is, near Ebenezer Secondary School, all the way to Pambros Beach, about an hour walk, to buy fish. We would cross at least three lagoons before we would reach the beach. It was such an exciting thing for us to do, and we always looked forward to it. Fast forward 25 years on, there is not a single lagoon left in the same area, which is now called Glefe Gbegbeise Opetekwe. Hey, human beings literally filled up all the lagoons with rubbish and sand, and sold the lagoon as land to people to build houses on them." I think I'll end here. Prof Chair, this is what Karen Kane was referring to. You can see that this is the lagoon. The white things that you see here are rubbish. So human beings have filled up the lagoon, and they have put up houses. That is what is happening in Glefe. When I went back to Dansoman Beach in 2021, December, this was what was left. You can see along this stretch, people have put up houses right into the sea. The picture is even clearer when you look at this map. I tried to get that of 1980. But I think we couldn't get the area photographs. So you can see, just look, about half of this area was made up of lagoons and shrubs and, you know, other water bodies. Now look here. The red means built-up area. So all these places have now been taken over in 2020. Now look at Shiabu, where I grew up. You can see that in 1990, the Chemu Lagoon was still there, fresh. Now look, it is gone. Chemu Lagoon is gone. Chemu Lagoon is now filled with trash. Honorable Esla built a floating bridge on it, and the bridge collapsed. So you can see all the water. Look, all the blue here represents water. Now, look here. Where are they? Gone. At the same time, the shoreline is also declining. As you can see from this map. This was the shoreline in the year 2000. Then this one, the red one here, is the year 2010. This is 2020. So you can imagine 2030, all the houses here, they will go away. I must concede that government has put in place some interventions. At the Glefe stretch, they have constructed a sea wall using rocks. So that might help. But you see, generally, on the average, we are losing about 1.2 meters of the shoreline every year. So you calculate, in the next 10 years, all these places will be gone. Of course, there are also natural causes. It's not just human, but it is mainly anthropogenic. So, whilst we were destroying our beaches and our lagoons, I have been a director of the Confucius Institute for 6 years. I've had the opportunity to travel to China. This is an amazing story. Shenzhen. Shenzhen, China was just a fishing village. Professor Wu, it was a fishing village. Now, in 2020, I went back to China. They were celebrating the 40 years of reform and opening up. And this is how Shenzhen has become. And I asked myself, couldn't we have come close with Glefe? Couldn't we? It is also about leadership, and it is also about the system of governance. So We've been operating with the 1992 Constitution all this while, 30 years. Isn't it time for us to pause and look at how best we can improve on our system of governance? Deng Xiaoping established Shenzhen as one of the special economic zones, and they were able to attract a lot of foreign direct investment. Today, the laptop that I'm using here is from Huawei. Shenzhen is the high-tech hub of China, the home of Huawei. According to Deng Xiaoping, it doesn't matter whether it is a black cat or a white cat, so long as it can catch mice. So it doesn't matter whether it's a free market economy or it's a centrally planned economy. So I think that pragmatism is the way to go. If you look at some of the things, we need state intervention. Why do we sit down for people to just grab land left, right, center, authorities look on unconcerned, for our paradise to be destroyed? Now, based on tourist area life cycle, the destination loses its appeal at the decline stage. So locals, developers, and tourists have descended heavily on the beach and stripped it of its former glory. Some of the beaches have become slums, if you go to Glefe. However, the loss of our paradise cannot be entirely attributed to tourism. In fact, if you look at Butler's tourist area life cycle, he places the blame entirely on tourism. That is as a result of the intrusion of a lot of tourists into the destination, thereby leading to current capacity levels being exceeded. That is what will result in the decline of the destination. But I am also saying that the behavior, the attitude of government and citizens can also heighten the pace of decline of a destination, as we have seen in the Dansoman Beach area. The loss of our paradise cannot be entirely attributed to tourism, even though tourism contributes significantly. So, as part of the United Nations process on the ocean assessment, which I am part of, I did a section on tourism, and it came out clear that our tourism resources are declining at an alarming rate. If you look all around the world, it is even more serious in Africa, where the system is lax and people take advantage of situations. In Paradise Lost, beaches are littered with solid waste. And this is common with the decline phase of the tourist area life cycle, as well as phase four of the self-destruct theory. Today, several beaches in Ghana are polluted and unattractive. Piles of rubbish, you know, feces, what have you. And you hear names like Baller Beach. You hear names like Titanic Beach. Go there and see. Walking down, as one tourist told me, he said, walking down the beach, one has to carefully pick one steps to avoid stepping in feces. So if you are walking straight, you are abnormal. You have to. So the beach was full of plastic. I will never go there again anytime soon. Recently, there was a media report on an African-American woman who lodged in one of the coastal resorts, got out, decided to take a stroll, and was confronted with rubbish. She said, I've never seen a beach with so much, to say it in American, trash, with so much trash. So we need to do something about it. In Paradise Lost, Mr. Chairman, everything seems to be disappearing. Disappearing wildlife, disappearing sands, disappearing monuments. When we were children, the coconut trees were intact. We would go to the shore and catch crabs. You know, there were three types of crabs. We had the alangmai. Alangmai, they were the very resilient ones that live right close to the sea. And then we had kaa. They can be found in the terrestrial, you know, environment. And then we had ngaa. They are found in the lagoon. I remember telling my dad, my late dad, this thing, and then he had a very good sense of humor. He said, Kofi, I think they were named after the sound that they emit when they cry. So you can see, coconut trees, sea turtles, babbler crabs, and other species of vegetation and animals have largely disappeared. Sand mining is still a very serious issue in our part of the world. Now they have adopted a new method. They go there at night, and then they pack the sand into cocoa sacks. And then, as you can see, this was taken at Oasis Beach, not far from here. And so we are losing our sand. The white gold, we are losing it. Of course, you can also blame it on climate change. I'll talk about that. Now, if research that has been taken shows that the rate of erosion in the coastal zone of Accra is estimated at 1.13 meters per annum, and this is quite high. In Glefe, it increases to 1.2 meters per annum. Some of our heritage sites, castles and forts, have also crumbled into the sea. For instance, Fort Congenston in Adan has completely disappeared, while Fort Princeton in Keta has been partially eroded. You can see from this map, which I took from the State of the World's Beaches 2022, you can see this is Ghana. The red shows the rate of erosion. So the larger the circle, the higher the rate of erosion, sometimes even more than 20 meters per year. That is quite substantial. Ghana is here. The green represents the rate of accretion. Accretion is the opposite of erosion. So we are talking about the accumulation of sand and land mass over a period. So usually when the sand is eroded, it is piled up in other areas. Or in the case of sand mining, we use it to build our houses. Now, if you look at Asia, you can see that there is a lot of accretion. I mean, China, UAE, United Arab Emirates, you can see the rate of accretion is quite high because they are embarking on a number of beach nourishment programs. I was in Xiamen some time ago, the Xiamen Beach. I was told that every year government spends a fortune to import sand to, you know, widen the beach. In China, they are even building artificial, you know, beaches. We are rather collecting the sand, the little that is left. I did a study on factors influencing visitors' perception of beach quality, and it came out that sanitation is a big issue. Poor beach quality, which is usually manifested in waste on the shore and also in the water. That was what I found. Among all the factors that I looked at, including security, physical features, and natural features, it was sanitation that emerged as the most serious issue. There is lack of basic amenities in some of our beaches. You know, all those beaches springing up along our coast here. You go there and ask them, where do they dump their waste? You'll be amazed. No proper waste management facilities in place. Some of the resorts, you know, discharge their sewage directly into the sea. So we have polluted beaches. The level of sanitation is quite serious. Also, in terms of unplanned and haphazard structural development, approximately 60% of the Kokorobite-Botiano coastline, where I did my study, the natural ecosystem has been converted into different forms of tourism-based facilities, such as hotels, resorts, and settlements. Now, what are the causes of all this? Climate change, yes. Global temperatures are increasing, and as a result, the polar ice caps are melting. Low-lying areas, including Accra, will therefore suffer such fate. Generally, tourism accounts for 5% of global carbon emissions. So tourism also sows the seeds to its own destruction. Another cause is indiscriminate sand mining, which represents private gain but public pain. People are profiting from the sand at the expense of the communities, resorts, and beaches that are along those coasts. And this also leads to loss of vegetation. Once the sand is collected, it exposes the vegetation to, you know, loss. Loss of habitat for marine life, and also renders the beach unsafe for swimming. Poor waste management is also a big issue. As a researcher, over the years, I have conducted a number of studies on waste management practices in hotels and also waste management. And I have always come to the conclusion that our understanding of waste management is waste dumping. So we collect the waste and we go and dump it. So the other methods, reduce, reuse, recycle, is not in our dictionary. So there is poor waste management along our beaches. There was a story of a fisherman who went to the beach to defecate, and he was accosted. And when he was asked why he was doing so, he said that he wanted to ask them a question. He said, if you collect the sewage from your homes, where do you go and dump them? Those were the times of Lavender Hill, Kolegono. All the sewage that was collected in Accra was dumped directly into the sea. And so if he has been, you know, very considerate to go and then dump it himself to spare you the trouble of transportation, you shouldn't be accusing him. Another cause is encroachment, unplanned development. There has been a proliferation of, you know, all sorts of facilities, including brothels, you know, drinking spots, accommodation facilities, chop bars, you know, along our beaches. And these facilities have been developed without any, you know, planning guideline. In fact, a lot of these facilities, I would say about 80%, do not even have licenses to operate. The land tenure system is also a factor. In some other countries, beach lands are vested in the state. In Ghana, our land tenure system is primarily under the customary tenure, where there is freehold for families, clans, and they decide what they do with the land. Even with the leasehold, foreigners can have land up to 50 years of leasehold. And so there is the problem of land grabbing. And it is therefore not surprising that when the paradise was found, people descended heavily on it. People were saying, the land belongs to me. I was telling a friend that all along, I thought the beach in front of our gate here, UCC, belongs to the University of Cape Coast. He said, no, it is somebody's private land. So, paradise regained. Have we regained our paradise? Are we regaining our paradise? Regaining our paradise demands resilience. And Mr. Chairman, please permit me to pay homage to my good uncle, Mr. Ben Aidan. Uncle, please stand up, let them see you. Uncle. Regaining paradise. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for honoring my invitation. Regaining our paradise demands a lot of resilience. Mr. Ben Aidan, having worked in some of the top, you know, companies in the UK, he could have decided to just invest his pension in some, you know, capital market and then enjoy the proceeds. But no, after he had met President Kufuor, who went to meet the Ghanaian community in the UK, he was convinced, so he decided to come back to Ghana and invest in a resort, a beach resort. So he constructed the Elmina Bay Hotel in 2009. And he followed all due process, acquired all the permits, EPA, GTA, you name it. He even fulfilled a corporate social responsibility by constructing a 2.1 kilometer road, which helped to open up the Mofrachim area. He realized to his dismay that the volume of sand that was being mined close to his hotel, around the Ankwanda area and then the Coconut Grove area, and by estimation over 1,500 cubic meters of sand was being scooped on a daily basis. So he realized that, you can see from the pictures, you can see from here. So the shoreline was just caving in and catching up on his facility. There was no office that he didn't go. Talk about DCEs, chiefs, went even all the way to the presidency to no avail. He was frustrated, but he couldn't watch his investment, his lifetime savings, to crumble into the sea. So he decided to construct a sea wall by himself. He spent about $1 million to construct a sea wall. And all that period, nobody came to his aid. It was not until 2017 that finally some help came with the construction of the Elmina sea defense wall. However, it also brought another issue. This is a beach resort, so his guests would have loved to have access to the beach. But no, because of the rocky sea wall. In Paradise Regained, we can equate it to the rejuvenation stage of Butler's model, where there is an effort to repair and reposition the destination. Regaining paradise requires greening and restoration. Some beaches and resorts are now planting new coconut trees and other ornamental trees. Beach nourishment programs. The government, for instance, embarked on a beach nourishment program around the Adan Beach on a 16-kilometer stretch. Sea walls have also been constructed in places like Cape Coast, Axim, Elmina. And rocky sea walls, undoubtedly, they help to build resilience and protect these coastal communities. However, they are unattractive to tourists. And besides, they are very expensive. The Ghanaian Times of 2022, June 16, reported that about $2.85 million had been spent on sea defense wall at the time. So as I speak to you, it has increased. I also want to ask whether massive beachfront tourism infrastructure projects, like the Marine Drive project, can help regain our paradise. The Marine Drive project has been touted as the single largest tourism investment project to be initiated by the government of Ghana since independence. We are talking about 1.2 billion. That's a huge amount. Approximately 241 acres of the beachfront around Accra, those of you who know the Arts Council area, is going to be developed into a typical tourism enclave with hotels, amusement parks, malls, and convention centers, as you can see from the picture, the artist's impression. It is also believed that this will also help address the issue of shoreline decline and beach erosion. And so it will address the problem of storm surges, which have gradually eroded significant portions of the land. At the beginning, at the inception of this program, a lot was said. I remember the Honorable Minister at the time, Catherine Afeku, said the marine drive waterfront promenade will create a safer, more vibrant waterfront destination that celebrates what makes Ghana special. Our breathtaking ocean views, vibrant music, art, and incomparable local craftsmanship. The project is not progressing as it should. It was launched in 2017. There have been problems with the funding and also even decongesting the area for the project. But could such a project help us to regain our paradise? The development of new resorts and other beachfront facilities which conform to approved standards. And I must admit that in recent times we've had some very good quality, you know, resorts being built along certain parts of our coast. For instance, we have the Aborigines Beach Resort in Keta. Very beautiful, pleasant, complying with all development standards. We have White Sands. White Sands has been there for some time. There is an ongoing one, Hilton Resorts, which is going to be a massive, you know, resort. We have Nyansapo Eco Resort, which is not far from us. I must say that Nyansapo Eco Resort belongs to KNUSD. All right. So we also have Axim Beach and other beautiful, you know, resorts springing up. But the question I want to ask is, do these developments represent paradise regained? Are we going to develop these resorts at the expense of livelihoods? Are we going to squeeze out local residents and deny them of their livelihoods and access to the beach? Again, if I cast my mind back to the 1980s, when the Dansoman Beach became very popular, at one point in time, some young men decided to barricade a portion of the beach, and they started charging money for people to enter. There was one fisherman, I know my sister and my mommy will remember, Ampaku. You remember Ampaku? A very stout, strongly built fisherman. When we told him, he just walked over, held the barricade, and then tore it apart. Said, "All of you, get in." The local people also need the beach for their own recreation and for them to carry out their livelihood activities. So in developing this resort, did we incorporate the local community's aspirations? Did we consider their livelihoods? Community participation and involvement are crucial for safeguarding our paradise. Again, as a researcher, I have done a number of studies on community participation in the communities around the Kakum National Park and also at Bobri Forest Reserve. I also did one with Ama Freeman on Bledi in the Volta region. And it has always been clear that local communities are subjected to some tokenism, that community participation is often just a facade. In reality, communities are not involved in tourism development. They are merely used, and in the end, their aspirations are not factored into such projects. So I believe that in future, I will interrogate this issue more, especially in our coastal communities. Where there are economic differences between the tourist and host, it can also result in some annoyance, certain irritations by the local community towards the tourist, where tourists engage in inappropriate behavior in these resorts and beaches. The local people might take offense. Doxey propounded a theory known as the Doxey's Iridex, where he talks about the fact that at the inception of tourism development, when the tourists start going into the community in small numbers, the local people become happy. So there is euphoria. They want to accept, you know, the tourists. They are happy to welcome them. As time goes on, they will now be interested more in making money from the tourists. So the initial euphoria will die down and it will degenerate into apathy. Now, this apathy will further degenerate into annoyance. When the impact of tourism starts emerging, the local people will now become annoyed. And to the point that if it is not addressed, it could lead to antagonism, where tourists will be attacked. And in places like Jamaica, along Jamaica beaches, tourists have been attacked due to this particular issue of antagonism. We should also be wary of large dominating resorts of disparate design in places like Adan and Kokrobite that look out of place and clash with the indigenous structural design. And this is often referred to as architectural pollution. In conclusion, coastal tourism destinations in Ghana have not followed a natural cycle of evolution due to political, economic, and environmental factors, which have resulted in the destinations remaining stuck in the early stages of exploration and involvement for quite a long time. Factors like climate change, sand mining, poor waste management, and encroachment have resulted in the degradation of some beaches, thus preventing the destinations from advancing through the life cycle. Some destinations, especially in Accra, Adan, and Sekendi Takra, they are on the brink of development. In those places, you can see that the multinational companies are now putting up resorts, foreigners have established restaurants, and so on and so forth. So they are on the brink of development. But largely, our coastal tourism destinations are at the exploration and involvement stages. In most of the beaches, the development has been devolutionary rather than evolutionary, resulting in paradise lost or decline, as I demonstrated with the Dansoman Beach area. Rejuvenation through the construction of beachfront infrastructure projects and facilities will only result in regaining the lost paradise if the concerns and aspirations of host communities are factored into such projects. Mr. Chairman, permit me to offer some few recommendations towards sustainable coastal tourism development in Ghana. So the first is legislation and enforcement. Legislation plays a crucial role in protecting our beaches by establishing legal frameworks and regulations that govern the activities and behavior of coastal residents and also the tourism industry. One of the earliest laws on our statutes books is the Beaches Obstruction Ordinance, CAP 240. I asked some of my lawyer friends whether this law is still prevailing or it has been repealed. And I was told that it was actually amended in 1951. But the law is still there, just that we are not enforcing it. But I think that we need laws that would address contemporary issues confronting our beaches, not some archaic law which has been outdated and may not be very relevant to our current circumstances. In places like Jamaica, Barbados, St. Vincent, Grenadine, Queensland, Montserrat, Mauritius, they have beach protection laws. We need relevant legislation to safeguard our beaches. In Italy, a couple were jailed for 6 years just for collecting a bottle of sand from the beach. Mr. Chairman, I'm not advocating for such a punitive measure in our context, because I believe our context is different. When I was growing up, my mother used to fry groundnuts. Yes. And she would send us to go to the beach and collect sea sand to be used in frying the groundnuts. Ma'amoboa. So, if this law is to be enforced in Ghana, we'll all be in trouble. So, we need to bring back the beach police to also enforce. The sand mining that goes on on our beaches is quite alarming, and something drastic has to be done. I will also advocate for the establishment of a beach authority, just as we have the Forestry Commission, and they have helped us to protect some of our forests. We also need a beach authority, because legislation alone is not enough or sufficient. Effective implementation and enforcement and public awareness creation in the communities is also imperative. We need an authority to ensure compliance with the law and also for us to protect our beaches. Yes, you can say we have a coastal development authority, but really, their mandate is not to protect the resource. Water Resources Commission, they are more interested in rivers and underground water. So we need a coastal or beach development authority. In other countries like Mauritius, Bahamas, Jamaica, they have beach authorities responsible for the protection of the beaches. I will also recommend that we take decisive steps in preventing further erosion of our beaches. Shoreline protection is imperative. I must commend government for building sea defense walls, but we should also earmark portions of our beaches for other beach nourishment programs. Beach nourishment involves, you know, dumping sand on certain portions of the beach to widen the shoreline so that, you know, tourism activities can take place unabated. Beaches are not just physical, but also socio-ecological systems. So we are not just managing the facilities that are sited on the beaches. We should also manage the ecological system. And so we need to ensure that environmental management practices are undertaken by the resorts and beaches so that we can safeguard the natural resources on our beaches. I will also talk about quality assurance as another recommendation. The quality of our beaches is essential for tourism development. It enhances the tourist experience and would ensure repeat visits. About 80% of the sprawling facilities along our beaches do not even have licenses to operate. So the Ghana Tourism Authority and other statutory bodies should develop metrics for assessing, grading, and classifying these beaches and resorts. We should also encourage third-party assessment of beaches. In Europe, they have the blue flag, which is a kind of assessment which grades and classifies beaches on the basis of environmental education and information, water quality, environmental management, as well as safety and services. And another line of my research has always been on service quality. I've done a number of studies on service quality in restaurants, in hotels. I believe that the quality of services in our resorts and our hotels along the beaches need to improve drastically. I would therefore recommend for training of managers and staff to help improve the quality. Finally, I will talk about community involvement as another recommendation. Involving local communities in coastal tourism development is imperative for the protection of coastal resources and the sustainability of the tourism industry. Tourism development policies should factor elements of community involvement and participation into such policies, so that if you are a resort, you are a multinational hotel coming to put up a plush resort in a coastal community, the local people, their interests should also be factored into it, not just the profit that you are coming to make. For instance, could we have a policy where a certain percentage of employees could come from within the surrounding coastal communities? And even where they don't have the requisite skills, we could train them. We could compel the hotels to train them before they are employed. We should integrate tourism into our local economies in general. So if you are a resort, you can source your fish from the local fishermen. You don't have to go to Tema to go and buy iced fish. So we need to integrate tourism into the local economy and balance visitor growth with tourism development. We should create decent jobs and economic benefits for our local people. Mr. Chairman, before I end, I would also like to highlight my contribution to knowledge. In almost 20 years of, in fact, in 20 years, because I started as a senior research assistant in 2004, I have been able to author 33 articles. Some were sole authored and some in collaboration with other academics from other parts of the world and within this university. I have also authored 8 books, 15 book chapters. I have done presentations at academic and non-academic conferences and workshops, about 45. Then I have also contributed to 2 technical reports. Generally, AD Scientific includes me in the top 10 tourism and hospitality researchers in Africa. In terms of my editorial involvement, I have been involved or have served on the editorial board of JOS, and I'm happy my editor-in-chief is here, Dr. Agulati. Yes, I have also been a co-editor of the Proceedings of the China-Africa Urban Forum since 2017. I have also edited Frontiers of Psychology and serve on the board of Cambridge Scholars Publishing for Tourism and Hospitality. I am also on the board of the Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Education and the editor-in-chief of the African Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Management. In terms of supervision and examination, I have supervised and co-supervised 10 PhDs. I have supervised 15 MPhils, and of course, still counting. These are the ones that are completed. I have also examined 17 PhD theses, not only from this university, but from other universities around the world. And I serve as external examiner for some 8 other universities around the world. So, Prof. Chair, because I started with a quote, permit me to conclude with my own quote. Like the ebbing tides, we are witnessing the gradual loss of the beach as our paradise. Yet through mindful stewardship and collective action, we can reclaim the shores and restore the beauty that we once cherished. Thank you. Share, share.
Let's do it for Professor Ishmael Mensah. Whilst he takes a seat, congratulations, sir. Pretty shortly, he would be acknowledging a few individuals. Thank you very much. Please take your seats. He would be acknowledging a few individuals. Ahead of that, I'll welcome Gideon and Kumsin Barnes back to give us a musical interlude.
Pray you be all right.
watch us where we go. And help us to be wise in times when we don't know.
Care to die, nel cuore resterà. Ricordaci che eterna stella sei. Nella mia preghiera, quanta fede che lead us to a place, guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved. Sognando un mondo senza più violenza, un mondo di giustizia e di speranza. Life be kind, el desiderio che non troviamo interno dentro sé. So let this be prayer just like every child. Oh, need to find a place, guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved. Need to find a place, so guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved.
Thank you very much, Gideon. I welcome Professor Ishmael Mensah back on stage to acknowledge a few individuals. Let's welcome him back on stage.
Thank you very much, Now, I can see far. Yes, because I stood on the shoulders of giants. I can walk because some people held my hand and they showed me how to walk. I want to acknowledge, first and foremost, my parents. My mother, Auntie Sisi, Cecilia Kujo. Yes. And then my father of blessed memory, Uncle John Mensah. He is not here with us, but I know he's in a better place. My late uncle, Mr. Blay Make, and his wife. I thank you so much. When I came to UCC at first, I had to stay with them for some time. They even helped me when I was in Gambia to gain admission. I'm so grateful to them, Auntie Mary. I also want to acknowledge my mentors, my lecturers, senior colleagues who have mentored me. They have held my hand and brought me this far. I want to acknowledge Professor Lord Adey, who could not be with us here this morning. I also want to acknowledge the late Professor Jerry Blankson. Both of them were my PhD supervisors. And then acknowledge Professor P.K. Achampong, who taught me at the undergraduate level. Prof. Then I also want to acknowledge Professor Kofi Ewusabo Asare. Prof, thank you so very much. Prof gave me an opportunity to travel to the U.S. to further my studies. Prof, I'm so grateful. Professor A.M. Abani, who is also like a father to me. Prof, I'm most grateful for all the support. I also like to acknowledge another mentor, Mr. Nkunu Achia. Sir, thanks so much for coming. In fact, he has been an inspiration. He taught me at the undergraduate level and also offered me a lot of opportunities. Professor Stephen Bugukendi, he's not here with us, yes, but thank you, Prof. Kendi. You supervised my MPhil thesis. Professor F.E. Amokwando. Prof. Amokwando is like a godfather, you know. He was my HOD. He gave me a lot of opportunities to serve. Prof, thank you so very much. Professor Barima Entry, who gave me my first teaching assignment. He asked me to teach level 400 students. I was scared, but after I had finished teaching, they clapped for me. So I knew I could become a lecturer. Dr. Ohinebe Achampong also was my HOD and my lecturer at the MPhil level. He could not be with us this afternoon. Dr. Vanessa Amua was also an inspiration. She gave me a lot of opportunities. I want to thank all the lecturers in my department. Because of time, I cannot mention all names. I also want to acknowledge all former VCs and pro-VCs. Professor Emmanuel Adoobin, who signed my appointment letter as a lecturer. Prof, thank you so very much. Professor Jenana Opoku-Ajiman, who also promoted me to senior lecturer. Professor D.D. Kupoli, who was my neighbor. Yes, he was my neighbor, and he promoted me to associate professorship. Professor Joseph Gate Ampia, he appointed me as director of the Confucius Institute and renewed my term. I'm most grateful, Prof. Professor Johnson Yankubwampong, who also promoted me to full professorship. Prof, thank you so very much. I'm so grateful. It was fun working under him. He was the board chair of the Confucius Institute by virtue of his position. Professor Otu Ellis, who is a father to me, former vice chancellor of KNUST, he could not be with us this afternoon. But Prof, wherever you are, most grateful. Professor Dora Edubando, who was a mother to me and still is. Prof, she also could not be here with us. Professor Rosemond Bohin, Auntie Rose, thank you so very much for what you've been doing for me and my family. Mrs. Elizabeth Obese, Director of Finance, I'm so grateful for all the support. And Dr. Mark Anthony Kobler, the librarian, who is my neighbor and also encourages me all the time. In my department, I want to acknowledge Professor Edem Amenume. Prof, thank you so much. I learned a lot from you. Ghana Fellows, Professor Kweku Buache, Vice Chancellor of CCTU. Thank you so much, colleague. Also, Professor Eunice Emison, my sister, Prof. Thank you so very much. Mr. McCarthy is not so well, so he couldn't be here with us. Thank you, Mr. McCarthy. My head of department, Professor Isahaku Adam. Thank you so much. Dr. Stephen Hiame, thank you. Dr. Mrs. Alberta Bondi Simpson, who is my sister. Dr. Kofi Bansah, thank you so very much. Dr. Mrs. Evelyn Addison Akotoyo, thank you very much. Dr. Mrs. Ewena Mafenyo Agbe, my daughter, thank you so very much. Dr. Charles Adongo, thank you so much. You are also my collaborator, thank you very much. Now, I was, by virtue of my position, I also served on the Faculty of Arts Board. So I want to acknowledge my provost first and foremost, Professor Kwame Osei Kwatin. Thank you so very much, Prof. Professor J.B.A. Afo was the dean at the time I assumed office, and he was my China mate. Prof, thank you so very much for all the support. Professor Akwesi Kumitreme, my dean, Faculty of Social Science. Thank you. And my vice dean, Professor Augustine Tanley, Professor Eugene Kufuor Datemafo, my colleague, thank you very much, Eugene. Also, Professor Simon Mariwa, Professor Safu Safu Kantanka, my current dean at the Faculty of Arts. Thank you so much for all the support. Professor Iwanya Miche, who was part of the professorial AMP committee. Prof, I learned a lot from you. Thank you so very much. Professor Divalera Botri, Aital, thank you so very much. And Professor Kofi Koda, the vice dean. Merci infiniment, mon patron. Also, Professor Kojo Opokuajiman, whom I took over from. Thank you so very much, sir, for your cordiality. Professor Hu Liankai, who was the first China director I worked, we had very good working relationship. He could not be here with us, he's in China. Thank you, Prof. Professor Zhou Guiping, in our short period of work, I think I learned a lot from you. Professor Wu Yame is here. Prof, thank you so very much. We've had a very good working relationship. Judy, thank you, my administrator, Judy Owusu-Pepra, and Robert, thank you so very much. My appreciation to the entire staff of Confucius Institute. I cannot mention all your names because of time. I also want to extend some gratitude to my friends. I will begin with my auntie. In fact, I cannot forget about my auntie. Auntie Joanna Akrofi. She came all the way from Nairobi, Kenya, because of me. Auntie, God richly bless you. You are a gem. Thank you very much. Then, my good friend, Dr. Isaac Esiama, is he here? Yeah, thank you. We go way back, way back. Thank you very much. Professor Kankam Buedu, he actually pushed me. He was always asking me, when are you going to do your inaugural lecture? We also go way back. Thank you very much, Reverend Prof. Professor Ernest Layo Okole and Dr. Mrs. Edna Layo Okole, thank you so very much for all the support. Professor Isien Bedu, thank you so very much for all the support. Professor Ebo Philip Bondi Simpson, thank you so much. He was also on me. When are you going to do your inaugural lecture? Mr. George Amfu Entree and the wife, Mrs. Dorothy Amfu Entree, Deputy Finance, thank you so very much for all the support. I cannot forget Dr. Dominico Usu. Doc, thank you so very much for all the support. Prof. Gachi, thank you so very much for all the support. Dr. Mrs. Regina Mwakusechi, thank you. I'm so grateful. Professor Robert, my collaborators, Professor Robert Ebo Hinson of GCTU, Pro Vice Chancellor, thank you very much. Dr. Emmanuel Duompong, who is in the Netherlands, thank you. Dr. Emmanuel Gamo is here. And Dr. Rickson Campbell, it's a surprise to see you. Thank you so very much. Dr. Razif Jamaluddin in Malaysia, I'm sure he's following us live. Thank you so very much. Ed Mayan. Thank you very much, Mr. Emmanuel Esibu, Chairman. We are so grateful for all. You are a gem. Thank you so very much. Mr. Benjamin Akins, thank you very much. Dr. Michael Norte, thank you. Engineer Jeffrey Akuran, thank you. Dr. Eko Dazi, thank you very much. Mr. Joseph Obri Ebua, thank you. I also want to acknowledge Nananum. My chief, my Jasehine from Krado, he has come all the way here. Nana Opoku Esel. Medasibebre, thank you so very much for coming to support me. I cannot forget all other chiefs who are here in Gadet and our traditional leaders. We are most grateful, including Osa Berima Kwesata. I also want to acknowledge the clergy, Apostle Eric Nyamiche, who is the chairman of the Church of Pentecost. Because of some other pressing duties, he couldn't be here with us. Apostle Nanaya Okumila Abi, the General Secretary, Apostle S.Y.N.G., the area head, Apostle Tuapia, who is also a good friend, Pastor Gideon Oseyapa, who is my pastor, Pastor Isaac Deku, thank you so, and Mama Deku, thank you so very much. You came all the way from Tamale because of me. God richly bless you. He always prays for us, and whenever we are celebrating our birthday, he'll call us and pray with us. Pastor, God richly bless you. I cannot forget Pastor Ernest Safujan and Pastor Frank Akuno. All other pastors here in Gadet, I'm so grateful for your support. I also want to thank my good friend and honorable, Honorable Kojo Asemenyi, who was the MP for Gomoa East, former MP for Gomoa East. Thank you so very much for coming. God richly bless you. You are really a good brother. And I want to also thank the president of SCAL International Accra, Mrs. Stella Penten. I don't know if she's here, but thank you very much, Mrs. Penten. All my co-workers in the Lord's Vineyard, where the harvest is plenty, but the workers are few. Thank you very much. I'm so grateful. The entire presbytery of PIWC, I'm so grateful. My classmates, some of them are here. I can see Mr. Kwe of Kwe and Kwe Brothers. Thank you very much. I can see Amma Freeman. I also have a high-powered delegation from TTU, Takrade Technical University. The Vice Chancellor of Pentecost University could not be here, but he has sent he has sent Dr. Kofi Buzia, the head of the Herbal Science, Herbal Medicine Department, to be here with us. Thank you very much, Doc. Also, Dr. Bismarck Owusu Setre, who is the director of the Institute of Leadership and Governance. Thank you very much for coming. I'm so, so grateful. I also want to acknowledge the registrar of Crown Star College, Mr. George Kofi Bainde. Thank you so much for coming. You told me you were coming, and I think you are here. I also want to acknowledge my family members. You know, I saved the best for last. My family members. I'll begin with my in-laws, my father-in-law of blessed memory, Mr. Kojo Dey. Thank you very much for giving me such an angel to marry. Thank you very much. And also, Mrs. Mary Dey, who also could not be here with us, but she's here with us in spirit. I also want to thank all my sister-in-laws, Sister Vic, Sister Mary, Sister Lizzie, they are all here. They came in their numbers to support me. And also my brother-in-law, Samuel Dey Party, thank you so very much. I'm so grateful for the love. And of course, their husbands and their wives, thank you so very much. My own brothers and sisters, Ebenezer, Evelyn. Evelyn, I have been on this road with you since we left Krado. We have been together. Thank you so very much. You've been a good sister. And Eric. Eric could not be here, but he also sent in his word. Thank you very much. All my aunties who are seated here, thank you very much. Those from Krado, those from Atuambo. My father's sister, Sister Nyamiye, is here. Yes, thank you very much. And then Sister Stella, yes. And Sister Araba, thank you so very much for coming. God richly bless you. I also want to thank all my nephews and nieces. Last but not the least, I want to thank the special people in my life. My beautiful wife, Professor Rebecca Dey Mensah, and my adorable kids, Nana, Araba, and Erabna. Please stand up, let them see you. Thank you so much for all the support. I know the times that I have been away from home, you have always endured it. Thanks for all the support. I'm truly grateful. Finally, I want to thank all of you for coming, and I pray for God's genuine mercies when you are going back to where you came from. Dr. Eudora Hagan and the team from Takoradi, thank you so very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Ishmael Mensah. Prof, you are not exiting yet. So we're going to have a brief ceremony, and that's what we call the robing. To help us do this, please help me welcome the College of Professors to help in the robing of Professor Ishmael Mensah. Let's give them a round of applause as the college approaches the stage.
Well, this is a special ceremony to now accept him into the College of Professors. So the first stage will be to remove his current dress, and then we robe him. Now, I've known Ishmael since 1996, when he was admitted to first year, and when we started the tourism program. So he's one of the first batch of students who were admitted for the program, and we are most grateful. So the ceremony is that he now becomes a member of a college which statutory advises the vice chancellor and management, and as well as the rest of the university. So Ishmael, you are welcome into the group. Can we now kindly help him to remove his current robe.
The professors will now take turns to congratulate him. Welcome the Pro Vice Chancellor, Professor Mrs. Rosemond Bohini, and the Registrar to take turns to congratulate Professor Ishmael Mensah. Former Pro VC, Professor Nelson Bua. Let's welcome the wife and the children as they take their turn to congratulate Professor Ishmael Mensah. I'll call on Professor's mother. The mother will take turn to congratulate her son. From the father's end, we'd also invite reps to congratulate him. Thank you very much. Members of the father's family are equally here. I'll call on in-laws. In-laws will be followed by siblings. In-laws, siblings should follow in-laws. Siblings would follow in-laws. Siblings. And then other members of his family, you're welcome to come upstage and congratulate him. Other members of Prof's family, you can join in to congratulate him. So she's an auntie to Prof and should want to make a statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, Vice Chancellor. Let me acknowledge our protocol. On this auspicious occasion, I would like to congratulate Professor Ish with a symbolic Maasai shuka, which I have brought from Kenya, because that is where we interacted for the first time. When Becky came to do her PhD in Nairobi, tagging along Nana. And I became the official babysitter on Fridays for Nana. And as we went through the lecture, it gave me a lot of nostalgia. But I thought that on this occasion, I would give you a Maasai shuka, which is actually a protective clothing for the Maasai people, and the staff, which is symbolic of leadership. Thank you very much.
Prof is now a full Maasai man. Thank you very much. I'll call on the Honorable Kojasimini, former Member of Parliament, Gomoa East, to congratulate Professor Ishmael Mensah. The clergy. Kindly take your turn to congratulate Professor Mensah. Thank you. Apostle Otuapia, you're here, and the wife. We extend invitation to all members of the clergy to congratulate Professor Mensah now. Dr. Anthony Texan from CCTU, if you're here, kindly take your turn after the clergy. Mr. Benjamin A. Kings, Manager Fidelity Bank, if you're here, kindly take your turn. Friends, please take your turn. All friends, please take your turn. So kindly note that when you enter from my right, exit from my left. Friends will be followed by faculty, social sciences. Friends will be followed by staff of the faculty of social sciences. Faculty of social sciences. Faculty of Social Sciences. The faculty will be followed by the staff of the Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management. Faculty to be followed by department. So can we have members of staff of the Faculty of Social Sciences stay on the stage? Faculty Social Sciences, please stay on the stage. You have a citation to present. Thank you very much, Faculty of Social Sciences. We welcome the Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management. Thank you, Faculty of Social Sciences. Let's welcome Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management. And they have a citation to present to Prof. Ishmael Mensah.
Citation to Professor Ishmael Mensah from the Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management. We at the department have followed your academic exploits with great admiration. This academic attainment of a professor in hospitality and tourism is a testament to your hard work, diligence, and perseverance. You have trained, groomed, and mentored many people and continue to be an inspiration to many. Your scholarly endeavors have contributed to making the department visible in Ghana and within the international academic community. May you continue to be a thought leader in hospitality and tourism and academia as a whole. We at the department say are equal to you as we join you in celebrating you on this occasion of your inaugural lecture as a professor in tourism. From the staff and students of the department, we say congratulations.
Thank you. Student of the department, are you here? Please come and take a photo. Let's speed up, please. Student of the Department of Hospitality. Let's double up, please. The students will be followed by staff of the School of Business. Students of the Department of Hospitality and Tourism Management taking their turn to congratulate Professor Ishmael Mensah. They'll be followed by staff of the School of Business. School of Business. Have School of Business here. School of Business would be followed by Confucius Institute. Confucius Institute. The China director is here. Professor Uyame. Confucius Institute, you take your turn after the School of Business. Confucius Institute. So Confucius Institute will take its turn. The director for the Ghana director for the institute would read a citation on behalf of staff.
Confucius Institute at the University of Cape Coast. Citation of honor presented to Professor Ishmael Mensah. In recognition of your meritorious and selfless service to the Confucius Institute during your tenure as the Ghana director, the staff and students of the Confucius Institute thank you for your dedication and hope you continue to be part of the development of the Confucius Institute at UCC. Congratulations and thank you.
Okay, in short, we say, Shang Gao Shui Chang. Yes, we wish that you always be there to support us as we develop. Thank you.
Thank you, staff of Confucius Institute UCC. We have the Ghana director and the China director, both with staff here to congratulate him. Members of PIWI Cape Coast, PIWC Cape Coast, you take your turn after Confucius Institute. Members of PIWC Cape Coast, please take your turn after Confucius Institute. And they'll be followed by alumni UCC. Confucius Institute, Xian Xian. I hear that. Thank you. Thank you very much, Confucius Institute. PIWC. PIWC. To be followed by alumni. PIWC to be followed by alumni UCC. PIWC, thank you very much. PIWC, thank you very much. Alumni UCC, PIWC, thank you. Please exit. No. Alumni UCC. Do we have custodians here? Let's speed up, alumni UCC. Custodians, please move, approach the stage. That will be the last photo we are taking. The gentleman, please approach the stage if you are here.
Please, we will sing our anthem. Oh, great Kesley Hayford Hall. 10,000. Oh, great Kesley Hayford Hall. We love and serve you evermore. And as we live in unity, great and zero be our pledge. Cast forward. We salute you. Cast forward. We honor you. Mother, cast forward. You are the sweetest, the greatest, and the best. Cast forward. We honor you. Cast forward. We honor you, my and I cast for you are the sweetest, the greatest, Sanaye, Sanaye, Saudonyanayo, Odonaye, Sanaye, Sanaye, Saudonyanayo.
Thank you very much, Casford. Thank you very much. At this point, Professor Ishmael Mensah would exit the stage from my right. As he takes his seat, he will shake hands with the chief of his town and then take his seat. The round of applause is not working for me. Let's do it for him whilst he takes his seat. Thank you very much. I would have to acknowledge a few personalities, but I believe that Professor Ishmael Mensah has done that extensively. So there will be no need for me to go through the list again. But let me do it for the Vice Chancellor who chaired this occasion, Professor Johnson Yakubu Ampong. Let's acknowledge him. Help me acknowledge the Pro Vice Chancellor, Professor Mrs. Rosemond Boahini. And I duly also acknowledge the Registrar UCC, Mr. Jeff Tay Emmanuel Onyame. Thank you, sir, for being here. We extend appreciation and warmth to all of you for being here. The College of Professors, we are indeed grateful for your time. At this point, I'll call on our chair to give his closing remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Professor Johnson Yakubu Ampong. We can do it better.
So I'd like to acknowledge some people, some professors here. They are professors emeriti. So far, the University of Cape Coast, we have, council has approved for my 5 professors to be elevated. They've been elevated before. Altogether, we have 5. But we have added, we had 3, and we have added 2 to it. So now we have 5 emerita professors in University of Cape Coast. Just to remind you that we have Emeritus Professor Ising, Emeritus Professor Amanume, and then we have Emeritus Professor Kobina Yangsin, but he has passed on. Then the most recent one, Emeritus Professor Gajipu. He's not here, he has left. And then Emeritus Professor Awisabo Asare. And I must also say that since 2001, starting with me, we have had about 11 inaugural lectures. And I have chaired at least 10 of them. The next one is going to be done on the 23rd of August, 2023, and it will be delivered by Professor George Amwako. After which we'll move on to 6th September, and it will be delivered by Professor Kwame Ose Kwaiti. Then coming to the main topic today, evolution of coastal tourism in Ghana, paradise found, paradise lost, and paradise regained. Professor Ishmael Mensah has actually taken us through all the phases of the paradise that we have. And he used the paradise metaphorically. He started by recounting his life experiences, that from childhood, areas that he stayed, and the fact that he was able to have experience, coastal life experience. Then he talked about paradise found. Paradise found, most of the time, they are pristine areas of the original seashore where all the natural environment is intact. Then when we identify such place, it attracts people to the site. A lot more development goes on, and then eventually become tourist attraction center. But by our activities in respect of development, eventually the area that is supposed to provide us peaceful environment, serene environment, that people will go there to enjoy life, eventually the place becomes polluted, and then we lose that paradise. And to regain it, it needs a lot of efforts. He has recounted many processes that we can go through to regain the paradise. And he ended by quoting that, like the urban tides, we are experiencing gradual loss of our beaches, but with faithful stewardship, we can reclaim the shores. So it means that to regain it, we have to do a lot of work. And he has stated many points. I could count about 8 of them, but we didn't want to go through all because we have sat here for a very long time. So we need to make sure that we change our attitude. It is not only with the seashore. It is also with our rivers. It is also with our forests. And even our own immediate environment. Self-destruction phenomenon must stop so that we can regain our dignity as Ghanaians, that will be respected as a country that with that thinks about the future generations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Chair. Thank you very much, Professor Chair. To help us with the closing prayer, kindly help me welcome Reverend Professor Kankambuidu to do us the honors.
Please let us pray as we stand. With one accord, let us appreciate the Most High God. Indeed, our eyes have seen, our ears have listened. Lord God Almighty, we thank you for this wondrous opportunity of listening to your son, Ishmael. Your word has been fulfilled in our eyes. I've seen this wonderful inaugural lecture. We pray, O Lord, that this inaugural lecture be impactful to us as a nation and university in particular. Now, as we live in for our various destinations, may your presence go with us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. The Lord bless us all and keep us. The Lord keep his face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace this day, now, and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you very much, Reverend Professor Kankambuidu. We shall remain standing as our Vice Chancellor with his entourage exit this auditorium. Our dignitaries who are here would equally follow the Vice Chancellor's entourage. The rest of us kindly note, as you exit this auditorium, you would pick your refreshment at the door. As you exit this auditorium from the back, you'd pick your refreshment.